morning, everyone, and welcome to worship today. To those of you who may be guests to our congregation, I want to give you a special welcome and thank you for joining us. I also want to thank everyone who has agreed to participate in today's service. One of the nice things about online worship is not only will you see familiar faces, but you also see some faces that come to you from around the country. So that's something that I'm very excited about. A huge thank you to Taylor Scaife for putting the services together every week. We really appreciate his work and definitely couldn't do it without him. I also want to thank then Nate Goff, Mike and Donna Sheehy, Kelly and Isaac Anderson, and Gretchen Bowes for the great insight that they've provided, and you'll hear here in a little bit. I also want to thank Blake Smith, who is a good friend of mine from Graceland, and he will be providing the ministry of music today, here towards the end of the service. Blake is a pastor at the Cedar Ridge Congregation down in Nashville, and I think you will very, very much enjoy his music. I also want to thank our speaker today. So today you'll be hearing from Joel White. Joel grew up in the Colonial Hills Congregation, but has recently taken a job with a church that led her out to Utah. So Joel is someone who has always had a wonderful spirit about her, has always been a leader amongst her peers, and so it's a great treat that through online worship we can have her back in her home congregation. I'm very much looking forward to hearing what she has to say today. Last, I want to thank you. And yes, I'm speaking directly to you sitting in front of your screen. Today and every Sunday, really, you are an active participant in the worship. You might be participating today a little bit more than you might have thought you would have been. In fact, some of you might want to go grab a pen and paper to have for later on in the service. So just a heads up there. Today's theme is unity through spirit. And wow, I don't know if I could have picked a better theme for the current situation we have right now. The Spirit is something that never leaves us, no matter what our circumstance may be. We may not always be aware that it's surrounding us, but it is there nevertheless. Today also happens to be Pentecost, for those of you who have been following your Christian calendar. It's a day that celebrates when the disciples were filled with the love of the Spirit. 50 days after the resurrection of Christ, the disciples felt a renewed sense that the Lord was with them. To many around the world, today actually marks the birth of the Christian church. So Pentecost is a pretty important day. I want to start off worship today by allowing us all some time to kind of get centered and invite the Spirit into our hearts. In the next few minutes, you may want to close your eyes or enjoy the images on the screen, pray or meditate, or just sit and listen to the guitar being played. But what I want you to do is focus on becoming aware that the Spirit is surrounding you. In the chaos of the times that we're living in, take this opportunity to really get comfortable, get centered, and allow yourself to feel the Spirit. Thank you. Now that we have all prepped for worship, join me in the prayer for peace. Holy Spirit of peace, in our confusion, we sometimes speak in the language of division. We ignore the pleas of brothers and sisters and pretend not to hear languages other than our own. Yet, in our moments of connection with the Spirit of peace, we find enduring truth through unity in diversity. We know that holy justice calls us into relationship with others whose superficial differences all too often become the brand of tribe, those who share values and passions. Let us insist on justice in the pursuit of peace. Let us find the ear of the powerful and give voice to the supplications of the weak. Let your Holy Spirit of peace reign over the earth. We pray in the name of the one who gives us peace. Amen.
Hey, Donna, Corey asked us to talk about spirit a little bit. How about this? I've got spirit. Yes, I do. I've got spirit. How about you?
Whoa, Mike. I don't think that's exactly what he had in mind. We're not at a football game. We're talking about a different kind of spirit.
What do you mean? There's nothing like the spirit at a football game.
Well, true, but not that kind of spirit. What we're talking about is the Holy Spirit. It's the feeling that God provides us, all of us, the assurance that He is with us. It's the way that we have felt, you know, unified, when we've been making phone calls to friends and family over the last 10 weeks and checking in and on Facebook and just feeling connected, you know, using Zoom and Microsoft Teams instead of our traditional meetings and classes and, you know, even birthday parties. This spirit of unity has been felt as moms and dads became their children's teachers and while also working from home and as essential workers towed the line day in and day out.
So, is the spirit with me when I find that missing piece to my puzzle?
Well, sure, but the Holy Spirit is just always uniting us, and we just need to pause now and then to recognize that reassuring feeling that everything is going to be all right and that God has a plan.
God's got this.
Yeah.
Living through a pandemic has caused an array of feelings for people. Feelings of fear, anxiety, loneliness, just to name a few. However, when I look back, I hope to remember the joy of watching Isaac and his grandma cook together, and of us playing Super Mario Bros. Wii, where he would definitely play the more difficult levels for me.
Yes, Super Mario Bros. Has definitely been a highlight for us during this time, as well as the Star Wars marathon. But it's also been good to use this extra time to be able to open up the Bible more and connect with God's Word.
And I will remember how we used technology to connect as a church family, how we used Zoom for Sunday school and YouTube for our church services.
We're all going to have different memories, but hopefully the most prominent will be of how we all came together amidst the madness.
Hi, I'm Nate. I was one of the millions who ended up losing their job during this pandemic. And honestly, I could not have rebounded without, you know, the help of my family being there and supporting me and helping me out with everything. There was a time where I couldn't pay for a medicine that I needed and I didn't really know what to do. And I reached out to them and they helped offer a solution and prayed for me and we ended up getting that figured out. And honestly, I couldn't have made it through this and stayed hopeful without their support and their love, and I've never felt more connected to them, even though we haven't been able to see each other in person. We've been able to FaceTime every day, group chat with all our families, all our nephews, nieces, or all my nephews and nieces, grandchildren, and it's just been such an interesting, tough time, but I could never have made it through without my family and have never felt more connected with them.
In my bedroom, I have this light green chair. And for 48 years, I have chosen to sit in that chair when I pray. It just seems like it's the right place to bring my heartaches, my concerns, my disappointments, and yes, even my moments of joy. But things have been a little different recently. I've made a few notes. I'd like to sit down in my chair and share them with you. This time, when I came to my chair, the worst thing in my 86 years had happened. And it happened to the entire world. How do I pray to my Heavenly Father? Should I express anger, disappointment? Should I plead for God to enter immediately in this dilemma? I think I know God pretty well. And I think He would say, Gretchen, this is the time to increase your faith and strengthen your hope. Well, my favorite line in the Lord's Prayer is the second line. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. Yes, the thought of the kingdom on earth enters my mind quite often, and it brings joy to my soul. our Lord keeps his promises, and I have great faith in that. So I told God, I will try hard to increase my faith and strengthen my hope, even though at times I have many thoughts of the terrible despair and the loss of so many wonderful people. But I will try to move on in thought to the hope of God's promises.
All right, now we're going to move into doing some active worship. So this is kind of what I was talking about earlier, about maybe needing some pen or paper. So there's going to be some questions on the screen. Each question, you'll have a few minutes to either discuss with those watching the service with you, or you can write down your thoughts and maybe give someone a call later and can discuss it with them then. Or you can pray about them or just simply meditate and think about it. But each question, you'll have about a few minutes. And so I want you to really think about each question as I read them.
When have you felt the Holy Spirit breathe new life into you? Imagery would you use to describe your experiences with the Holy Spirit? Thank you. When has the presence of the Spirit brought new understanding to your life? How can we find unity through the Spirit within our congregation, or within Christianity, or within our community?
Thank you.
Friends. Whether you are a longtime participant in Colonial Hills Worship or have stumbled upon our streaming for the first time today, welcome. I'm so glad that you're here. This morning, as we worship and connect virtually, I am very grateful for the Holy Spirit, which cannot be bound, a spirit that unites us despite our separation, and a spirit that calls us to meet the challenges of our time with renewed hope and faith as we pursue Christ's mission. That spirit is the topic of our service this morning as we explore and celebrate Pentecost. And it is in that spirit that I'd like to begin this morning by sharing a few words to a song some of you might be familiar with. It goes like this. I may not live to see our glory, but I will gladly join the fight. And when our children tell our story, they'll tell the story of tonight. Raise a glass to the four of us. Tomorrow, there'll be more of us. Telling the story of tonight. These words come from a new favorite musical of mine. Perhaps you've heard of it. It's called Hamilton. The musical recounts the life story of Alexander Hamilton, one of the founding fathers of America. This song is sung by four early revolutionary thinkers whose ideas are not necessarily popular and aren't even really that safe, but who are so passionate about what they believe that they can't help but act on it. I like the song because the lyrics are catchy and the music is engaging, and overall it's pretty inspiring. But as I prepared for my Pentecost sermon this morning, these words took on new meaning. Just like the early Christians who gathered nearly 1,800 years before them, these men showed up and they witnessed the broadening of a movement. The idea of freedom had always been central to America and the founding fathers represented in this song, but in a single moment, this idea was broadened to include so much more. It became something worth fighting for, something that could inspire a revolution. The same is true for the early Christians who gathered to worship and witness the broadening of Christ's mission to include all of creation. A relatively small group, we're told, of around 120 got together to worship. Their beliefs were not popular nor widely accepted, and in many cases, they weren't safe. They knew that they might never see the glory of the coming reign of God on earth, and yet they gladly joined the fight. And sure enough, their number turned into more of us, and they baptized 3,000 new Christians as a direct result of their witness. And here we are, thousands of years later, telling the story of that night. As we explore this story, we'll do so with the help of the scripture text coming from Acts, which recounts the early Christian movement's encounter with the Holy Spirit during the Jewish harvest festival known as Pentecost. Before we dive into this text, however, I think that it's important that we explore the celebration of Pentecost and its importance to us today. I think it's safe to say that Pentecost, at least in the Christian context, is somewhat of a forgotten holiday. Christians are very good at observing Christmas and Easter, but when it comes to Pentecost and what it means for our discipleship, we struggle a bit more in that remembrance. In fact, when we reflect on Pentecost and its modern-day parallels, we might even feel inclined to deny divinity's presence in those experiences, just like some observers did during the endowment experiences thousands of years ago. But why is that? Why are we so quick to forget this day on the Christian calendar or question how the Spirit comes to us? There might be a few reasons for this. Perhaps we're shy from a more enthusiastic observance because Pentecost is just too difficult to understand, to wrap our minds around. Maybe, though, it's not a matter of understanding at all. maybe we're afraid to get too close to the Holy Spirit. Celebrating the coming of the Holy Spirit on all human flesh, including mine and yours, may be too personal, too much. There are a number of reasons why we might ignore this important day. But if we don't give Pentecost proper observance, we risk losing too much. We don't need to understand the Holy Spirit in order to know that we need the Holy Spirit. Being afraid of what we encounter with the Holy Spirit and what that encounter means for our lives isn't a reason to reject its presence. According to one theologian, when we disengage from Pentecost, we lose a number of things. He says this, "For one, I do not know why I am praying for anything. If God does not touch human life somewhere, somehow, then what good are prayers? Secondly, how do I get and stay connected to God? If the role of the Holy Spirit is to teach us things that Christ taught us, to offer healing and reconciliation, to inspire us to love, then how does all of that happen if we dismount from Pentecost? When we don't observe Pentecost, we surrender a huge piece of what it means to be in relationship with God and to follow Jesus Christ. Furthermore, as we look to the world we live in, I can't think of a more appropriate and necessary time to remember Pentecost than this, specifically in light of the theme for today's worship, unity through spirit. Humanity, I think we can all agree, is perhaps more divided than ever before. Whether they be politically, racially, economically, or socially motivated, these divisions can prevent us from recognizing the inestimable worth of all people and from fully embodying the mission of Jesus Christ. In contrast to our current condition, Pentecost offers hope in the midst of division. The Holy Spirit broke down walls that divided community gathered in the name of Jesus in that time and that place, and we can do the same today when we accept the Spirit's presence. It will require us to remain open and willing, even when our instincts tell us to be rigid and defensive. Hope persists and unity is possible. The Spirit on Pentecost Sunday showed us that that is true. Hoping for the unity the Spirit can bring to these situations does not diminish the challenges associated with finding solutions. It only acknowledges that they are possible and that hope is present. As we witness the growing gap between the rich and the poor, growing manifestations of poverty and unchecked disease, growing divisions between nations and within economies, and growing intolerance of any opinion or ideal other than our own, let us, as David M. Bender says, celebrate our glimpse of the work of the Spirit as we await again its fresh and life-giving movement. Now that we have a better understanding of why Pentecost is an important Christian observance, let's look back to its origins in Christianity. After Jesus' death, resurrection, and ascension, many Christians were waiting for the next step. They were waiting for the coming of the Spirit which had been promised to them by Jesus. During the Jewish Harvest Festival, a small group of Christians gathered in observance and were surprised when the Holy Spirit came in undeniable and unimaginable ways. The arrival of the Spirit brought transformation and courage to the small group gathered. It brought new and deeper awareness of God's continued presence in the world and allowed people to understand and be understood in new and meaningful ways. Rather than persisting in black and white thinking, those who embrace the Holy Spirit, realize that God is a God of dialects rather than dualisms. They were open to new perspectives and new ways of seeing. The day itself is exciting and it deserves our attention, but I think it's important that we not ignore what happens next. Those who experienced the Holy Spirit left that place transformed. Their experience impacted their life in such a way that they invited others to be a part of it. They began to practice a radical unity, a new way of being that turned the culture on its head and provided living water to all who thirsted. Some might even say that they lived the very Zion of our hopes and dreams in real and tangible ways. How amazing is that? That is what the Spirit can do. As we reflect on the experience of Pentecost and on its impact on the community of believers, I think it's important that we ask ourselves how we will respond to the Spirit's continued presence today. The Spirit is constantly working to usher in a fundamental reshaping of creation, and the Spirit invites us to be part of this process. This reshaping is difficult and scary, but as Doctrine and Covenants section 164, verse 9b reminds us, when our willingness to live in sacred community as Christ's new creation exceeds our natural fear of spiritual and relational transformation, we will become who we are called to be. The rise of Zion the Beautiful, the peaceful reign of Christ, awaits our wholehearted response to the call to make and steadfastly hold to God's covenant of peace in Jesus Christ. If we accept the invitation to be part of this transformative process, we must intentionally work to ensure that our understandings and theology don't confine or diminish the Holy Spirit, but instead enable us to be responsive to it. Unfortunately, the world is full of examples of the harm that is caused when people of faith claim God-given authority without being open to the love and compassion the Spirit brings. People are hurt, worth is diminished, and creation is harmed. This is not God's will. I'm going to say that again. This is not God's will. If we truly want to be disciples of Jesus, we cannot let our limited understandings get in the way of God's transforming love. The dangers of irresponsibility and irresponsiveness are evident. However, when we are responsive, and when we claim responsibility for the precious lives that we encounter, the same radical unity expressed as a result of Pentecost 2,000 years ago can happen in our communities today. In fact, when we are responsive and responsible, we become part of the widening circle begun in Acts. We become part of God's work in the world, not just for a select group of people, but for all of humankind and all of creation. We become part of the growing momentum, building ripple by ripple toward the ultimate reunion of humankind, not in spite of our differences, but in full embrace of them, truly unified in the Spirit. Imagine for a moment what type of world that would be. May we be humbled in our call to be co-creators of that world, and may we be fully committed to our role in making that dream a reality. In this moment, here today, we are witnesses to the continuing broadening of Christ's mission in our world. We've been invited to receive the Holy Spirit and respond to that invitation with whole life stewardship and commitment to God's vision for the world. May we accept this invitation and move forward in the light of our divinely instilled call and vision. Amen.
We're young and able and bring together when the day is done. The door is always open, your picture's on my wall. Everyone's a little broken. With a crowded table and a place by the fire for everyone. Let us take on the world while we're young and able, and bring us back together when the day is done. And bring us back together.
Dear Heavenly Father, hear our prayer for unity, to live in peace and harmony with one another, united in one mind in Christ. May we live out our lives led by the Holy Spirit so others will be drawn to Christ. May we continue to build bridges and seek reconciliation. And just as at Pentecost, when people were united by the word of God preached and heard, may our words unite all those who hear to the heart of God. Help us to understand and live out the truth that there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. And let us bring that unified spirit to the world. Amen.